Welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-proclaimed Sondheim expert. Welcome to our new season on Into the Woods. I don't really want to spend a whole lot of time here up front because this is a jam-packed episode. I will just point out that if you did not hear for some reason the short little audio update I posted, I believe yesterday, that there is a podcast meetup happening this coming Saturday. So if you're hearing this coming Saturday, October 14th, at 6 p.m. If you go to Instagram or Twitter, you should see some more information posted there. We are going to be meeting at the Mercado at Mercado Little Spain. So October 14th, that's this Saturday at 6 p.m. We'll be there for a little bit before I have to head on over to watch. Here we are at the shed, which is very exciting. Like I said, this is our introductory episode. This is a very long song, and as you can see by the runtime, this goes on for a while as well. With a first-time guest, and stick with us because we get to talk a little bit about the Into the Woods Junior and why I think a lot of people might have the wrong impression about what that is supposed to do for young theater goers and young people who are wanting to get into the theater. So stick around. Let's jump into our conversation about the prologue of Into the Woods.
Once upon a time,
I wish
in a far off kingdom,
more than anything,
lived a fair
more
maiden, a sad young lad,
I wish,
and a childless baker.
More than life,
I wish,
with his
more
wife.
More than anything,
more than the moon,
I wish.
The king is giving a festival.
Kevin Quillinan, thank you so much for joining me here today.
Thanks for having me, Kyle.
This is going to be so much fun. This is also a beast of a song that we are going to be delving in here today.
Yes.
We were kind of joking beforehand, like this, just as performed, this song is 15 minutes long.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to try very hard not to have this become a 2.5 hour long podcast. But before we even get into the song, Kevin, this is your first time here. So I'd love for you to first, like, maybe just to introduce yourself and like what your role currently is.
Sure. Long-time listener, first-time guest. I am the director of theater education at Riverside Theater in Florida.
How long have you been there for?
As of last month, I've been here 17 years now.
Okay.
And prior to that, I taught at a high school for 6 years up in Massachusetts. I went to school for theater at Shenandoah University in Vermont. Virginia. Kevin,
okay.
It's early.
That's all right. Whatever. All the V's, they all sound the same.
Yeah, they all are.
What was your first introduction to theater? Like, what made you fall in love with theater?
I was kind of a late bloomer, but it's funny looking back on it along the way, Jesus Christ Superstar kept popping up for me when I was younger. And then that was like the first show I did when I was in high school. I was one of only two freshmen to get cast as an apostle. When I went to college, it was my first show my freshman year. And again, freshmen didn't always get cast, but we had a lot of men and many got cast. And it's one that kept popping up over and over again. And I could go on and on and on. It feels a little disrespectful, though, on the Sondheim podcast to be talking about Andrew Lloyd Webber. So, but that's kind of the start of it. But I didn't really get involved in it until high school. My brothers, who were older than me, they were always stage managers of the show. So I had seen some of the shows like them. And then when I was coming in freshman year.
So you were a Nepo baby is what you're trying to say.
I totally was. Absolutely. And so when I went in, my eighth grade year, I shadowed my brother who was stage managing, because then the next year they didn't have a stage manager. So as a little baby freshman, I was going to get to stage manage. And then that first year, my director, he announced that we're going to do for the musical Jesus Christ Superstar. And I'm like, I remember that show. My dad had the Brown album, all that stuff. I'm like, can I audition for it and then stage manage? And he's like, sure. So I did it, loved it. And I'm like, from now on, I'm just going to stage manage. The next year, he announced we're going to do West Side Story. And I went, can I stage manage and be in it again? And he went, Kevin, shut up. Just keep auditioning. Just keep auditioning. You're good. You know. And which then kind of brings me to my first kind of Sondheim introduction through West Side Story. I didn't really get involved until high school. But then when it bit me, you know, the theater bug bit me hard.
What did you play? Did you play a role in West Side Story?
I was a jet. I was like jet number 22, you know, but
sure. Just part of the gang. Yeah. When was the first time then that you really understood, like, oh, there's a Stephen Sondheim, like, when, like, you started to, like, really uncover his work?
It was soon after that. It was probably around the same year, because I grew up in New Jersey, and I went to an all boys Catholic school, and it was a religion class of all things.
Wow.
And I'd been doing, like, West Side Story, but to me that was a Bernstein piece. I didn't really think of the lyricist, you know. Then in our religion class, he showed us the, you know, incredible PBS Into the Woods special.
Right.
And over a couple of periods of class, we watched it. And that really just kind of blew my mind. And that opened it up. And that was the first, oh, this is, you know, Stephen Sondheim. And so then from there, it was kind of like, got the ball rolling from there.
Having just revisited that PBS recording, there's nothing quite like crying before 9 a.m. because I was watching early in the morning, the other morning. But, like, it still holds up, I'm going to tell people. Still holds up.
It's one of those where it, because I've directed the show a couple of times. I had to fill in as the narrator one time that I directed it because somebody dropped out. It's one of those, though, where it's like, man, it's just hard to shake, especially Joanna Gleason. Like, you know, line deliveries, and just, like, it is so hard. And then directing, you know, children in it or teens in it, you know, to be like, you got to watch this, but you got to try and, like, not let it sink in.
Yeah,
but even for professionals, it's hard for them not to try and just mimic, because it's, like, perfect. It's one of the few things where you could just see, it's like, this is just perfectly done.
I mean, I have to say, I know that I am so incredibly biased in a few different ways. But that Joanna Gleason performance, some people are like, how could she have won over who she was nominated against at the Tonys that year? I honestly think she deserves it, so hands down deserves it. Because when you see anyone else do The Baker's Wife, and there's been some great performances and some interesting choices, in the back of my head, it's like, still not as good as Joanna Gleason. Like, I haven't seen anyone, like, improve upon that performance, where in other roles I've seen other people do interesting takes in the other roles.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, the ghost of that performance just lingers so strong. And I saw the 2002, I guess, revival, on the first revival Broadway. I saw that in previews, and it was just like, this is fine, this is great, it's good. Yeah. But, like, nothing, I mean, that one just leaves such a mark, that original PBS special, that it's just hard to get past. And hearing from people who, you know, performed in it, and other professionals, everybody always admits that like, they're like, it's just hard, you know, because it's just so perfect.
Now, part of the reason why I really wanted to have you on here is that you sent me an email and yelled at me and called me names.
I was very polite.
But I thought that you have such a great insight into the fact that there is, of course, a junior version of Into the Woods. Mm-hmm. And there was a previous episode where we kind of disparagingly, like, cast aspersions against the junior version of Into the Woods. And I think you have a great support or an argument for having a junior version of Into the Woods.
That's one of my tender spots. I can let most things roll, but throughout my career in education, I'm so used to people, I mean, just overall taking jabs at children's theater and to begin with in education programs, and fine. But, you know, in the junior program, and I'm going to be the first to admit, there is nothing funnier to me than attaching junior at the end of, like, entirely inappropriate shows, like, like Assassins Junior, Dreamgirls Junior, you know, shows that should not.
Superstar Junior, let's do
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Hedwig and Angry Inch Junior, you know, like, that's a go-to joke, gets a good laugh every single time. So, you know, so I totally, you know, admit to that, you know. But I do hear people sometimes more seriously taking, like, jabs, especially the Into the Woods one. And that's the point I wanted to bring up, and being like, oh, they don't even do the second act, which is totally fair, 100%. The thing that I learned, because I do a lot of work with the Music Theater National Company, we take kids every year to the Junior Theater Festival, where they have you perform 15 minutes of junior shows, and there's, like, literally, like, thousands of kids from all over the world, really, groups from even, like, South Korea and Australia and England, and all that stuff have come in the past. It's a huge celebration of kids' theater. But the thing I learned from talking with the CEO of MTI, Freddie Gershon, is that the impetus of the junior program came from Stephen Sondheim, which people don't know.
Right.
Freddie said that in, like, the early 90s, Sondheim came to him and said, the art form is dying out. I mean, the 90s 1970s, as many of us may recall, was like a time when
dark time,
you know, Sunset Boulevard was the only nominee essentially against like Smokey Joe's one year, and like, and all of this sort of like craziness, you know. And so Sondheim said, you know, we're really going to lose the art form if we don't find a way to capture kids and capture their attention when they're young. And he first proposed, he offered up Into the Woods. He said we should do a version that's for them, that's catered to them, to get them hooked on theater younger. And they're getting to do cooler shows, they're getting to do like kind of more hip shows. And so Into the Woods was actually the first one that had been was being developed. Annie Jr. ended up being the first one being released, which actually was my like senior thesis project, my senior year in college.
The junior version specifically of Annie?
Junior Annie, yeah. Annie Jr. And that was a new thing at the time. And like, so the local elementary school wanted to do it. So they reached out to Shenandoah, which is in Virginia, not Vermont, and said, despite rumors you may have heard. And but they said that, you know, so two of us went out and we kind of co-directed it. And that was sort of my big thesis for the year, because at that time I was an education major, theater education major. So, but anyway, Into the Woods was the first one that they actually were developing at the time. And hearing over the years different things of Sondheim, and that's one thing we were talking about ahead before this too, is that how Sondheim not only was, he had such high esteem of teachers. You know, he called, you know, teaching like the most noble profession, you know, that you can have. And and he himself was a brilliant teacher, and he himself was a great teacher. So he had such respect for it. And different things I've heard too, that like they said, he said with Into the Woods, he specifically was like, you know, the first act works as a piece in of itself. Develop that as a piece. And, you know, they'll have time to learn, they'll discover the second act somewhere later in their lives or their careers. And then it'll be a whole, open up a whole new world to them. But the first act does work so perfectly and so brilliantly as this one piece. So they did that. And the junior version, for those who may not know, junior versions of shows generally take a longer show, cut it down, make it more appropriate.
Is it made into like a one act usually?
It's always a one act. It's always about generally about an hour long. Into the Woods is maybe one of the longer ones actually, because they actually cut very little out of that first act. There's some little like surgical cuts of just lines and stuff just to bring the running time down a little bit. But I mean, everything is pretty much intact and whole. The major line change, which I know will hit when we get later in the song, but instead of the witch saying, raping me. Yeah, they change it to robbing me, harassing me. And so like, you know, they'll do little things like that. And also sometimes change the keys so that it is more appropriate for like middle school, early high school voices, or even elementary school. So those are kind of the tweaks they do. Into the Woods is one of the rare ones where, yes, it cuts out the second act, but as a piece, it's kind of is the whole first act. It's not like condensing major chunks of the show down into one thing. So then sometimes the shows can feel truncated, or especially if you really love the longer show. But so I think to me, Into the Woods really works well. In fact, and last summer, during the summers, because here in Florida, our downtime is actually the summer, whereas most theaters, you know, that's their big prime season. For us, since we have a different schedule with tourists and everything, we the summertime is when the education program can take over our main stage, the professional stage, the stage of professional equity actors use throughout the rest of the year. And last year we did the full length Into the Woods with our older students up through college. And then after that, we did Into the Woods Junior with our younger students, using the same sets, most of the same costumes. Nice. And it's kind of a nice format that way. And then the younger kids get to kind of still have the same experience as the older kids, but it's in a material that's more suitable for them and all of that. And last summer we were gonna do Newsies. And I guess I should say summer 2022, I guess summer is over. We were going to do Newsies, but then when Sondheim passed, my wife, who's also my music director, suggested, you know what, maybe we should do Into the Woods. Maybe we should do that one instead, which I thought was a brilliant suggestion as kind of a tribute to him. We turned that whole summer. In addition to just rehearsing the show, we are also doing like workshops and classes and whatnot. And I did like a whole nerdy deep dive into the history of Sondheim and showed That's various cool. clips and all sorts of stuff over a couple of days. And now I have all these little Sondheim nerds that I work with. So like all the kids are like all obsessed, and hearing them say, you know, when we started like a circle at the beginning of a show and say your name and your favorite show, and hear kids saying like Merrily We Roll Along and like, you know, stuff like
That's
that.
So I'm
like,
funny. You've created your own ladybirds. That's what I you've know. Done.
Exactly.
So there's a few different things there. What immediately comes to mind is very similar to, I guess, like what the hard sciences do, mm-hmm. which is like for young students, you're being introduced to a very basic concept first. Like, just understand this very basic concept, and then we can layer and layer and layer on top of it as we go along. We're not necessarily like censoring information for you. It's just like so you can like be brought into this instead of going super high level first, and we get you, you know, fall in love and experience different things so that it's appropriate for your age level. I think that's kind of what this junior thing kind of feels like to me, the way that you describe it here, at least.
I mean, my junior cast last summer, it was hilarious then hearing them like near the end of the rehearsal process, when we're doing warm-ups or whatever, waiting to get started, hearing them in the corner doing, "Well, it is my fault. I was given those beans, you were traded," and they were doing the your fault from the second act, and they were like deep in all that stuff too. So it's like, yeah, they found it. And that's the overall thing. Like the juniors are not meant to be, this is the end goal, this is the end result. Only the junior version exists. You should never do any other version of the show, or this is where your career stops. Just more of a starting point. I mean, and Sondheim was always so interesting hearing the stories from these people who worked with him on this stuff, and that he like even when they were developing, like they did then do the high school editions of shows, which generally only really change the keys sometimes. Mostly keep things intact. I mean, even like swears and whatnot is still intact. And like the Les Mis, they did the Les Mis one first. And then when Sondheim was working with them on the Sweeney Todd one, he said to them, he's like, however, you have to, he's like, we have to release a accompaniment with this. We have to have a band orchestrate this and play it so the kids can sing to the tracks. He's like, because he's like, otherwise you're going to have these high school bands trying to play Sweeney Todd. He's like, and that's just unfair. Yeah, just, you know, he's like, that's not just right. So again, Sondheim as teacher, like looking out also for the students. And yes, you know, in his heart of hearts, he's like, yes, live music, we should have live band, the band people. However, in terms of exposing it to theater and exposing kids to theater, at this point, the priority needs to be this and not like struggling with,
You've been playing the trumpet for, you know, 7 months. I'm going to throw you the score of Sweeney Todd to try and play.
Right.
Hey everyone, just Kyle breaking the conversation to tell you about some of the people that help this show continue to go. If you would like to help support this show for absolutely free, you can do so by giving a rating and review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. That's of course greatly appreciated. Putting Together is an independent production, so if you would like to help monetarily, which will only help to grow and make this show better, you can do so over at our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. However, you could be someone like Erica, who just became a brand new patron over there this very week. Thank you so much, Erica. I also need to give a huge thank you to the God That's a Good tier from Patreon of Barry, Derek, Alex, Christopher G, Christopher L, Jack, Luis, Mike, Robert, Stephen, Todd, and Witty. You can go over to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast for more information. Once again, thank you, Erica, but let's get back to the show. All right, well, what song are we talking about here today?
We are talking about the prologue today.
That is correct. So this is the opening number for Into the Woods. This is going to be the easiest time I ask this question here this season, which is, what's happening right before this song starts?
Nothing.
Literally, the curtain has opened is basically what has happened.
And we see our narrator, and that's about it.
Now, when people are listening to this, you'll already have noticed it that last week I did an entire episode discussing like the inspiration of how this show came about. And I also went into four of the fairy tales that are referenced inside the show, four of the main fairy tales that are referenced within this show. I wanted to ask you, like, are you familiar with the actual Grimm's fairy tales, like the versions of the fairy tales that are inside of Into the Woods?
Yes, I am, but I think, and I'm probably one of many, I was not so familiar with especially the deep, dark aspects of it until I first learned Into the Woods and everything about the stepsisters. Toes and heel and all of that stuff. I didn't realize came from real, you know, I was very much a Disney kid and
picking out the eyes, all that stuff.
All of that stuff. Yeah. All of that. So now I do. And I'm very well versed in, you know, kind of the history of, especially what Sondheim and Lapine were pulling from.
Yeah, I pulled this out here. I'm going to hold this up for the camera that no one listening is going to see. So I was able to bust this out, my Folk and Fairy Tales version 3. So I went to university. I got an English degree, which made me unhirable. And
I got a theater for youth degree. I can't exactly throw stones.
Part of that is I got very interested in children's literature. So I actually studied quite a bit of children's literature, and I took this one course about fairy tales specifically and like how those have changed through time. Anyways, I only bring that up. I just wanted to point it out if people have not listened to last week's episode, because I'll go into much more detail there. But there are the three kind of big people when it comes to fairy tales. There is the French person, Charles Perrault. We have the Germans, the Grimm brothers. And then we have the, I always forget, Dutch? Hans Christian Andersen, I believe, was Dutch.
Yeah, yeah.
So those are the three people that when you hear fairy tales, or if you have been seeing a fairy tale adaptation, one of those three people is probably who they are referencing inside of there. The hard part gets into this is because different cultures have the same story, just in a slightly different format. Like Little Red Riding Hood as a good example. There's like in China, in Germany, in England, in like all over the place, there is a Little Red Riding Hood story just told slightly differently, but some of the main points are the same. But the Grimm's fairy tales are specifically what they're looking at. So that's why it's not a glass slipper, because it isn't a glass slipper in the Grimm's version of the tale. So that, anyways, that's the thing to say, like, they're really focusing on the Grimm's fairy tales, except for one of them, which is Jack and the Beanstalk, because Jack and the Beanstalk has no Grimm's brothers example. There was no Jack and the Beanstalk, at least in the German folk tradition that anyone can find. So they're taking that from the English. There's an English folk tale about Jack and the Beanstalk that they're basically taking that and inserting it into there. My history with this is seeing a version of Into the Woods way back in my high school years, because I was part of this thing called theater club where we went and got to see live theater at one of the bigger cities. And we did a talk back for Into the Woods, and there was someone in the back who kind of did what you were talking about, which gave us this crash course of like, here's who Sondheim is, this is what he's doing inside this show, this is how they adapted this originally. And that was really my first like click over moment, like, this sounds really cool. And then I watched the show, it blew my mind, and I was like, oh, I need to see more of what this person is doing. And that kind of started me on the road to becoming the Sondheim fan that I am. So Into the Woods is the reason why this podcast exists, basically.
It's awesome.
So we finally got into this show. This is a very long way of setting up the fact that I think so many people, and there's nothing wrong with this, but there's so many people know like the Disney version of the fairy tales.
Right.
They think sometimes coming into the show is like, what? Why is this so dark and violent in some cases? And like that's really what these were. Like these were cautionary tales, folk tradition. People sitting around a campfire and either trying to scare you or give you a lesson of some kind. And it's interesting they was able to bring that into, at least in 1988, a modern context.
Yeah, and going back, and I'm not going to constantly be referencing the junior version, but going back to that, like I said, they changed the one line for the witch, but all the other darkness is in the show. You know, the subtext of, you know, I know things now is there if you're looking for it. The stuff with the stepsisters, none of that is toned down. None of that is, you know, Disney-fied or anything like that. So it still keeps it to, you know, the rawness of Into the Woods that we, all of us, you know, have fallen in love with.
This is many years before Shrek would also subvert fairy tales.
You know, watching this stuff again, preparing for this, I was thinking about that too. I'm like, yeah, this is such a world. This show cannot just exist anymore, because now everybody would have to be so snarky. And of course, there's those moments in the show, and there's the moments with the witch, but it's not in the same way. And there's a narrator isn't like, you know, there's little winks here and there to things, but more like, well, you know how these stories go, but not like, aren't these stories stupid? Like, there's none of that sort of like tone to it, which is also refreshing.
Okay, so this is how we're going to start. You're right. The narrator comes out on stage and intones, once upon a time. And Cinderella goes, I wish in a far off kingdom, more than anything, lived a young maiden, more than life, a sad young lad, more than jewels, and this is when Jack says, I wish, and a childless baker, more than life, and then Cinderella and the baker go, I wish, with his wife, and Jack goes, more than anything, more than the moon, I wish the king is giving a festival more than life. I wish to go to the festival more than riches and the ball. I wish my cow would give us some milk more than anything. I wish we had a child, is what the baker says. And then Jack is milking Milky White. Please, pal. I want a child. Squeeze, pal. I wish to go to the festival. I wish you'd give us some milk or even cheese. I wish we might have a child. And they all come together. I wish.
Once upon a time, in a far-off kingdom,
I wish,
lived a fair maiden,
more than anything, more than life,
a sad young lad,
more than Jew,
I wish,
a childless baker,
more than life,
I wish,
and his
more
wife,
than anything, more than the moon,
I wish,
the king is giving a festival.
More than life,
I wish to go to the festival.
More than riches,
and the more.
I wish my cow would give some milk.
More than anything,
I wish we had a child.
I want a child. I wish to go to the
festival.
I wish we had a child.
I wish.
Listening to the clip would make this make a lot more sense, but it's obviously different people saying those different lines. What do you want to say, I guess, about this opening bit?
Well, this opening, the one thing, and I love like hearing Sondheim talking about it, how that opening, even notes, the notes after the narrator says once upon a time, and you have that brilliant
yeah,
and he said that he wanted it to like grab an audience and wake you up. And, you know, you hear once upon a time, you're like, oh, I've heard this a million times. OK, we're going to be lulled into. And then all of a sudden, boom, you know, it's not going to be that. And it's going to be something a little bit, you know, unsettling, setting you a little off center before the show begins.
Yeah, it is that weird. Like it's two notes and he's going up in if I remember him speaking about this correctly. People can go to YouTube and watch Into the Woods, a conversation piece, all one word. Where it, I will say, for anyone that's not a nerd, I can't imagine anyone finding this interesting. It's a little bit dry as far as things go. But for me, it was fascinating because it was really made for people who are going to be putting on this show from MTI. Like you're getting this sent to you from MTI so that you can be like, okay, this is how you cast it, direct it, talk about the music to the kids sort of thing. Sondheim talks about that, like that ba-dump is so important. And then the vamp that's going on behind this, he says, is very easy to be like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's like, you don't want that. You want it to be steady, but you don't want it to be like too like, I guess fun, for lack of a better word.
Gentle, yeah.
It has to just be steady.
Yeah, and it's funny hearing that. Definitely made me think exactly of their same exact approach to Sweeney Todd, where they wanted that that whistle to be like a horror movie and to like scare you, and you know, and not as maybe not as definitely not as harsh as the Sweeney Todd whistle, but it serves the same effect of like kind of waking you up and leaving you a little bit, you know, off kilter as the show begins, which is just so brilliant and a really, really just cool, subtle sort of, you know, thought behind it all.
There's also, we talked about this a little bit back in our Sunday in the Park with George season about how Lapine really loves to bookend things.
Right.
Which is like, whatever it is, like White, a Blank Page or Canvas is how that show both opens and ends, where that speech is said. And then Into the Woods, it's I Wish. I Wish is said, is the first thing that's said, and it's the last thing that's said. And Sondheim writes about how I think that's in the conversation piece too, perhaps, about how if the actress is really on top of her game, she'll say I wish in the exact same way
at the beginning, at
the end. She wants it to be said and sung exactly the same. But wishes are very important in Into the Woods. I just want to take a moment here, but like there's a few different themes I think are being explored within this show. But one of them is this idea of wishes. Like they're calling them wishes because this is a fairy tale, but really these are goals, is really another way that we could put this into a modern context, and how it's good to have goals, but also when you achieve a goal, sometimes you've achieved this thing that you've always wanted, but it doesn't actually go the way that you thought it was going to go after you've achieved that.
Yeah, and what comes after happily ever after?
Yeah,
and even, you know, and I know you're many weeks away from this, but yeah, how the whole ending of the show is, yes, there is a resolution after Act Two, but then sneaking in that little Cinderella, I wish, it just speaks to the humanity, it speaks to the circular nature of, like, yes, she's gone through hell. All of these bad things have happened to all of them. They've come through it. But still, I kind of, you know, and so it's just like it's going to keep going on. You know, there could be a third act and a fourth act. And, you know, it could have just gone on and on and on with these bad decisions. And going to the I wish of it all, plugging your past guest, Ben Rimmelauer's podcast, The Giants in the Sky, where I forget which actor he was talking with, but they said that in early readings for a little bit, it was she was saying, I want. And and stepmother would say, you want to go to the festival? And they said just one time, you know, Stephen Sondheim came in and said, you know what, let's just change that one word. Let's just change it to I wish. And they're like, just that one little tiny change just opened up a whole new world and changed everything about it, which I was like, oh, it wasn't even I wish from the start. Like it's crazy hearing it developing and how, because I wish is just such a huge part of the show. And it's, you know, it's pretty amazing hearing that.
And it makes it like, again, it's what Sondheim always talks about, which is content dictates form, right? Because these are fairy tales, wishes play such a big part in fairy tales, or can in a lot of fairy tales, where there is a wish that is granted, or that's what their motivation is to go and get the thing. So anyways, just changing that one word, I think, is such a brilliant move on their part. This, of course, is very... Sondheim talks about how this is essentially what he's doing within this opening, what movies do all the time, which is cross-cutting, especially if there is a film that has like two or three different plot lines going on at the same time, like just cutting between them.
Yeah.
And in a movie setting, we totally understand what's going on. We're understanding the forward direction. They were cutting back and forth between places and times, potentially. And he's like, how can I do that musically? And how can I like show this on stage? Yeah. So we're being introduced here, even in this very short opening that I just read out here, we've introduced all of our main... Well, I shouldn't say all that. Most of our main cast have now been introduced, and we basically know what they're going for. The baker and his wife want a child. Jack needs to go and sell his cow. Cinderella is wishing not to be in the position that she's in. She wants to go to a festival. There's one aspect, and I'm going to try my best until we get to the end of the season where we talk about the movie version of Into the Woods in much more detail. I'm trying not to slide into super negativity, but I have a lot of bad things to say about that movie. But here's one of them, and that I know this is such like a nitpick in many ways. So many people would be like, I'm just finding things to try and be mad about. There is a I think it's Lapine who talks about this in that conversation piece. And he says, when you're putting on this show, an audience needs someone to follow through this story. Otherwise, what can happen to the inexperienced director is that everyone gets lost in the shuffle where there's like too many competing things. And it's like, we need someone to keep coming back to and focus on. And he says, one of the easy ways on the stage is like, I don't care how you put anyone else on the stage, but the baker and his wife have to be center stage. They're the first people you see when that curtain opens up. They're the people who you're focused on, and they're the people who you're following. In the movie version, we follow Cinderella. She's the first person we see as she's walking through I Wish. And so just by the nature of filmmaking, she becomes our main character throughout that movie. And if you look at the poster, that's kind of also supported, I think, in my argument. And I think that's the wrong choice to go in, because the baker and the wife are the main characters in the story, and they really should be the ones who we're focusing on. Even though I know Cinderella is the first person to sing, I still think we should be seeing the baker and the wife first and then moving off into the other people. Anyways, that's me being super negative, but...
No, I agree with you. I put that on this morning because it's been years since I didn't even watch it last year when I was prepping for, you know, doing Into the Woods again. And I haven't seen it in forever. I'll just put on the beginning. I lasted like halfway through it, and then I had to put on the original Broadway cast video again as a palate cleanser because again, it's perfect. And this is not the place to get into my nitpicks either with that opening, but I definitely agree with you on that. Like, it's just a little, the perspective is muddy.
Is off,
in addition to having the baker, clearly James Corden is the one doing the narration, and that just makes it muddier too. But anyway,
we'll get into
that. That's another thing.
I'll point this out too. My other nitpick is that they switch the baker and his wife's lines. So they give the lines to each other, which again throws it off their characterization. Because say what you will about that movie, I actually think it is, for the most part, really well cast.
I agree too.
Give them a disservice.
I forgot, like watching it, watching it like the first couple minutes, I'm like, okay. Ooh, Christine Baranski. Okay. Yeah, ooh, great. Tracy Ullman. Ooh, and like all the people I forgot about. I'm like, okay. Yeah.
Just so people don't think that I'm going to be so mean, when we get to them, there are actually a couple of moments in that movie that I think are really well thought out and have some really great ideas. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, I think it's a mess. So, talking about Christine Baranski here, though, so we get more into the Cinderella plotline here next. The stepmother, and we have Florinda and Lucinda, who are the two stepsisters. That's the other thing I should say. Like, people often think about the ugly stepsisters, but that is not true in the Grimm's version. They're not ugly. They are very beautiful women themselves. And talking to Cinderella. So the stepmother begins here. You wish to go to the festival? The poor girl's mother had died. You, Cinderella, the festival? You wish to go to the festival? What, you, Cinderella, the festival? The festival? What, you wish to go to the festival? The king's festival? And her father had taken for his new wife the festival. A woman with two daughters of her own. Look at your nails. Look at your dress. People would laugh at you. Nevertheless, and the stepsisters and the stepmother saying, you still wish to go to the festival, while Cinderella is singing, I still wish to go to the festival. And they go, and dance before the prince?
You wish to go to the festival.
The poor girl's parents had died.
You, Cinderella, the festival.
Well, you wish to go to the festival. The festival. The king's festival.
And now she lived with her stepmother.
The festival?
Who had two daughters of her own.
Look at your nails.
Look at your dress.
People would laugh at you.
Nevertheless,
you still wish to go to the festival and dance before the prince.
All three were beautiful of face, but vile and black of heart.
Well, I know, speaking for myself, there's a whole generation of people who the word festival is ruined for now in regular conversation, and cannot help but say it as the festival.
Speaking from
experience, we used to have this long running charity or fundraiser here called the Festival of Trees, and there'd be so many of us who'd be like, okay, then next weekend we have the festival coming up. You know? It's kind of like that again, ruining it all. But no, I mean, again, the rhythm, the overlapping of everything, the way they all kind of feed into each other is just so brilliant. And even reading, I'm hearing you reading out the lines, you just cannot help but hear the music underneath. Like, it's just so all married together.
Yeah, I think that's important too, is that within this song, this opening song, a lot of the different musical themes are starting to be introduced here as well. That keep coming up. Even like that opening that we talked about, like that ba-dump, and then the vamp and stuff like that, does come back every so often throughout the show as things are happening. Even for scene transitions, that is sometimes what's going on underneath it. But yeah, this section here is good just to kind of be introduced into, I would say it is kind of a smart thing to introduce probably the one that most people are going to be familiar with, like the Cinderella story. It's like, yeah, we are familiar with this one, you know, stepsister, stepmother, totally get it. The narrator continues on by singing, all three women were beautiful of face, but vile and black of heart. Jack, on the other hand, had no father, and his mother, and this is when Jack's mother says, I wish, well, she was not quite beautiful. I wish my son were not a fool. I wish my house was not a mess. I wish the cow was full of milk. I wish the walls were full of gold. I wish a lot of things. And then there's a conversation here back and forth between Jack and his mother. But eventually we get thrown over into Little Red Riding Hood, who says, I wish it's not for me, it's for my granny in the woods. A loaf of bread, please. To bring my poor old hungry granny in the woods, just a loaf of bread. Please.
Jack, on the other hand, had no father, and his mother,
I wish,
well, she was not quite beautiful.
I wish my son were not a fool. I wish my house was not a mess. I wish the cow was full of milk. I wish the walls were full of gold. I wish a lot of things. Oh, you foolish child, what in heaven's name are you doing with a cow inside the house?
A warm environment might be just what Milky White needs to produce his milk.
It's a she. How many times must I tell you? Only she's can give milk.
Why, come in, little girl.
I wish. It's not for me, it's for my granny in the woods. A loaf of bread, please. To bring my poor old hungry granny in the woods. J- just a loaf of bread, please.
Cinderella's stepmother.
Well, again, the bringing Jack's mother into it. You'd mentioned before about like the themes of, you know, the musical theme of I Wish and like, but I'm coming through. Well, now they're introducing, you know, it, in the dialogue behind, underneath the dialogue, you hear the what's going to come up later, the Jack, head in a sack, like that little kind of musical theme that is playing underneath that. So already he's layering in like all of these little themes. And of course, I know we'll talk about the bean theme coming up later on with the witch. But, you know, already there's all these little themes that are going to start coming in. Little Red's theme is going to start introducing itself as well, too. So already all these little things are threaded in. And I mean, another thing I wanted to mention with, and you could just see this when you see how like intricate everything is. It seems like so much with, you know, as you well know by this point of all the episodes you've done, how much Sondheim is constantly rewriting, constantly last minute writing, which definitely comes into play with this show too, and pulling out brilliant numbers at last minute. One thing that really stood out to me though is that it seems like in all of the different readings and all the different versions of this, everybody pretty much says that the prologue was kind of set in stone from the beginning, and like once they had which characters they were going to use, it seems like this like 15 minutes or so never really varied too much. Like there are lines here and there and some parts of the witch's rap changes, but most of it is kind of, and so you can kind of see that here with the way the themes and everything interconnects and weaves through, and it seems like a solid piece.
I could definitely see that, like him just taking the time, like, I need to know what my musical themes are that I'm working with. How can this be deconstructed going forward? I need to know all of this from the get-go. And we'll get to it, but there is a song that is eventually cut from the show called Second Midnight that was like, they spent so much time on that song, which is very intricate, very much like this piece, but like partway through Act One. That was there for a long time before they decided to cut it out. Like, apparently the whole cast hated it, so they were very excited when that song was cut. So
it's very interesting, and how so many much of it though they still kind of cannibalized for
other songs.
Children Will Listen and other stuff too. That's interesting too, that like how much he put into it, and then but again the whole Kill Your Darlings aspect of it, which is again another thing that's amazing, how much this, it's such a huge chunk of the show and it stayed pretty much intact throughout every incarnation of the show.
I also think Barbara Bryan is so wonderful as Jack's mother. She's incredibly funny in that performance, and I do like the fact like everyone is talking about their wishes, about what they're trying to go and accomplish, and she has like six wishes, right? She's bang 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 bang. Everyone else has basically the one like driving force, and basically if we're talking about the full version of Into the Woods, hers is like, I want to be rich and I wish that my son wasn't a twink idiot. That's basically what
I know.
That's basically what her wishes are.
Yeah, one of my favorite little sub stories in the whole show is just how I'm trying to think of how to phrase. Well, I'll phrase the way Sondheim does actually, how dim-witted Jack is, and how
dumb.
He's really pretty dumb all throughout, and it's so funny being like, well, is that just the perspective of the mother? But then reading a bit from Sondheim where he's like, yeah, he's just so dim-witted. They're talking about when he's doing the I Guess This Is a Goodbye. And Sondheim says it's his only song that, like, one of his few songs that doesn't rhyme. And he's like, because Jack is just so dim-witted, he can't even think of a rhyme. And I'm like, that is hilarious. And like, this is actually, this is canon from everybody else that Jack is just kind of behind.
Which is also, again, not to, I feel like this is going to be just a recurring thing. Another, I think, mistake that the movie does is to cast kids in the roles of Jack and Little Red. Part of their motivations, too, is that these are prepubescents and being exposed to, like, the dangers of being adolescent or, sexual advances and all that kind of stuff versus being, like, a little kid sort of thing.
Yeah, I felt the same way about that 2002 revival, too, because they cast, like, not, I think Jack was an adult. I think, but like, probably early 20s, maybe late teens. I haven't looked into, but definitely was younger, definitely played younger. Red was definitely probably middle school aged, early high school age when she did it. And it feels, you know, to go on a totally side tangent, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Clifford with Martin Short. I was just, I just got into a deep dive reading like a oral history about that movie. And for those who haven't seen it, like Martin Short at 40 years old is playing a 10-year-old boy. And it's not like a Jack situation like that Robin Williams movie. It's like, no, he's just supposed to be 10. And it's very weird and very funny. You have to be just a certain sense of humor.
Charles Grodin's line reading is like, oh, can you be a normal kid? Can you just be normal?
It's I watched so that over and over to the other day. And like Martin Short, just a little like, reactions like trying to be normal. It's hilarious for that scene alone. But in reading that, they were talking with Richard Kind, who plays the father, Clifford's dad in the show, and like in the movie, and just hates him. And he was saying that, like, because originally they weren't gonna have it be a real little kid playing it, and it was like a late last minute, like, this show's not work, this movie's not working, what if we got Martin Short to play a kid? And everyone's like, that's so stupid, let's try it, why not? And he was saying, he's like, some of his scenes with him, he's just so enraged with him and just like clearly hates him. He's like, it's better because it plays off that, like, no, I hate Martin Short and I hate what he's doing to us, rather than if it was a real little kid. He's like, now you're in like serious like abuse, you know, and you
I know, right? Just really there is a difference kid. Here. Yeah.
And so, yeah, you're right. So with this, I feel the same way. Yeah. When it's real kids in that day. Now, I say this as someone who just directed little kids playing these roles.
Sure.
But that's a different thing, too. That's a different context.
But yeah, everyone's context, a kid then in that case. So there's a different again.
Exactly. Exactly. The dynamics are different. But
not to go on too much of a digression here. But as we're recording this just a few days ago, a couple days ago, there's this article that blew up online about someone who didn't like Martin Short. And they wrote an entire article.
That's why I fell into it. I think that's how I fell into that other article. Yeah.
I will say this is classic internet. If you actually read the article, they actually end up saying how much they like Martin Short. Like, it's just a kind of an attention grabbing title headline that they gave to it. But regardless, it made everyone be like, well, I like Martin Short for this reason, which got me into this video of someone says like, no, a lot of people didn't like Clifford when it first came out. And it's like, yeah, but those people are boring. That's what Martin Short said.
Yeah, I love that. I love that.
Whatever.
Yeah. He's like, I wouldn't want to have dinner with them.
So the narrator continues on. Cinderella's stepmother had a surprise for her. I have emptied a pot of lentils into the ashes for you. If you have picked them out again in 2 hours' time, you shall go to the ball with us. Little Red Riding Hood continues on, and perhaps a sticky bun or four. And Cinderella sings, birds in the sky, birds in the eaves and the leaves and the fields and the castles and ponds. And Little Red, and a few of those pies, please. Cinderella continues, come, little birds, down from the eaves and the leaves, over fields, out of castles and ponds. Jack, no squeeze, pal. And then Cinderella does her little vocalization, ah. And then Cinderella, quick little birds, flick through the ashes, pick and peck, but swiftly sift through the ashes into the pot.
Cinderella's stepmother had a surprise for her.
I have emptied a pot of lentils into the ashes for you. If you have picked them out again in 2 hours' time, you shall go to the ball with us.
And perhaps a sticky bun or four.
Birds in the sky, birds in the eaves and the leaves and the fields and the castles and the ponds.
And a few of those pies.
Down from the eaves and the leaves, over fields, over castles and ponds.
No squeeze, man.
Well, you know, first going back to what you were mentioning before about the kind of cinema feel of all of this and the cross-cutting back and forth. I mean, speaking to, you know, we've mentioned several times about, you know, theater nerds and all that. But, you know, this definitely points out how much of a film nerd Sondheim was. Yeah. And, you know, it's clear like going to want to make a horror movie like Sweeney Todd and that sort of stuff, that really this intercutting interplay back and forth is just so brilliant. Now you have these stories established, but then layering on top of that, what I think James Lapine or maybe just what they had arrived at was, rather than focusing on one story, they picked these several stories because they said if we focused on just one story at a time, it'd be boring. And, you know, because everybody knows the story, you know, the Cinderella story, you know, the Jack story. So if you just sat in one world and let them tell their story, then you move the Red story, then you move the Jack story, the audience would be like, okay, we get it already, move on.
Yeah, I feel too much like one of those list songs that are like, okay, I get it. So get to the end of the list. But I think to that point too, what they mentioned, like a lot of these fairy tales, because they are adding things into the narrative. But even with that, it's like all these fairy tales are so short, right? So to be like, we're going to give you the first half and the first half and the first half is like, well, we're kind of halfway through the plot already, and it's only been 5 minutes.
So. Right, right, right. Once you go up to the, you know, giant's realm and come back down, you steal the stuff, and okay, now what?
Mm-hmm. Also, by the way, there's, I don't know if Sondheim writes about this or not. I can't remember now. So many of those fairy tales deal with threes. Like, they go back for three nights, or he goes up three times, or they go to this thing, or they need three things that they need to go and grab. I don't know what the deal is with threes necessarily, but it's a very common occurrence throughout these.
Yeah, it's almost like the comedy rule of three they always talk about, too. And like, I thought that was interesting. And that was another difference from what we know from the Disney version, is how Cinderella goes back three times to the ball. And that's what intrigued either him or Lupin or both, where they went, why would she keep going? Why can she not decide? Which was their hook for Cinderella, which is really interesting and very smart, too.
Mm-hmm.
Sondheim and Lupin, they know what they're doing. That's what I'm here to say.
We haven't really talked about some of the rhymes that have been going on here, but this is some of my favorite stuff, like eaves with leaves we have. And then those short little staccato notes as she goes, like, flick through the ashes, pick and peck, but swiftly sift through the ashes. There's a fun little patter that the actress can go through.
Yeah, that almost could be used as like a theater warm up, unique New York, you know.
Right.
Pick and peck, but swiftly sift through the ashes.
Then we get into Jack's mother returns. Basically, she instructs him, "Hey, you have to take Milky White to market. Please get more than five." Where Jack hears less than five. She says, "No, more than five." I will say, as it's written out here in this book, the only recording that I could find that actually includes everything that is included, meaning like these interstitial bits, is the newest Into the Woods recording with Sarah Bareilles.
Yeah, I was surprised.
It's the only one that actually includes all of like the dialogue stuff. Every other one at least cuts out some of these things.
Yeah, listening to that again, I was struck by that too. And another thing, I mean, maybe we'll mention this later, I was struck by, because I'm so used to that PBS recording that it's been a while since I really, truly just listened to the soundtrack. Sorry, cast recording.
Yeah.
And hearing Bernadette is almost, really kind of tighter here, I guess you might say. Mm. Like, it's not so loose and not so funny. And not so, like, she's just very, strict to, the cadences. There's little personalities here and there, but not so much as is in the PBS special. So that was something that kind of stood out to me, too, and how, this recording is just, again, being spoiled by that PBS special.
I've talked about this before. I think as a theater fan or musical fans in particular, you get your favorite recording and you listen to it so often that that is now in your mind.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
For positive and negative ways, but this is how it has to be performed.
Yes.
I'm guilty of that 100%. Like, I'm going to throw myself under the bus here. But then it's you see the magic of live theater, where it's yes, that original cast recording is beautiful, I love it, and then you watch the PBS version where they are a little bit looser in some things, and it's okay, so it was different every night. They had a little bit of flexibility, but on a recording it's hey, we have to fit this onto one record. So you have to be to the point. You cannot go off we have written here very much.
And I never realized about that PBS recording. I never really put it together that it was the cast returning, that it wasn't it was near the end of the run and most of the original cast was not with it anymore. So it was all of them returning, and how they said it was kind of like rock stars performing, like the audiences. They said it felt a lot like what they keep saying the recent revival was like, where it was everybody knows, everybody loves it, they're so excited to see this. And that's how the people were. They had 1 week with Bernadette and everybody back in, and so that now watching that again, I'm that's why this energy is so crazy, because it wasn't just in the course of a normal run, it was the returning, the heroes coming back into which is kind of fun, and then being I get a second chance to do all this fun stuff again too, which is cool.
So Jack's mother sings, Jack says, but he's she's my best friend. Milky White's my best friend. And Jack's mother says, look at her. There are bugs on her dugs. There are flies in her eyes. There's a lump on her rump big enough to be a hump. But son, we've no time to sit and dither while her withers wither with her. And no one keeps a cow for a friend. Sometimes I fear you're touched.
Listen well, son. Milky White must be taken to market.
But mother, no. He's the best cow.
Look at her. There are bugs on her dugs. There are flies in her eyes. There's a lump on her rump big enough to be a hump. But son,
We've no time to sit and dither while her withers wither with her. And no one keeps a cow for a friend. Sometimes I fear you're touched.
This is my favorite thing, becoming a character as I say these lyrics outside. Okay, I feel like there is a few iconic lines throughout this show.
Oh, yeah.
But like withers wither with her is probably an all-timer.
Withers,
which
wither,
is like,
wither.
I know it's being a bit cute, but at the same time, it's like, it works. It's grammatically correct.
Yeah. Yeah, I love those moments when Sondheim definitely like flexes his muscle. And it's just like, okay, I'm trying to be subtle and I'm trying to be character based, but let me show off just a little bit once in a while, you know. And that's really fun. And again, like, you know, of course the lyrics and everything is, but I cannot separate even as you're reading, I'm hearing that cowbell in my head of the little plunk, plunk, all those little plunks that they have all throughout there when she's talking about the rump and the hump and all of that stuff. Like, it's just so perfect, and it all just like melds so well together.
Just to explain some things, if people are not like up on their animal husbandry all that much, so a wither is basically like the shoulder blades of an animal, cow or horse. That's what the withers are. And then dugs. Do you know what dugs are?
No, actually, I'm embarrassed to say. No, I never really even thought about
it. It's a very, very archaic way. I don't know if anyone nowadays would even call them this, but they're the udders. That's what they're called. Those are.
Okay.
So there's bugs on her dugs, flies in her eyes. Obviously, we're rhyming these words together, these internal rhymes that are going on here. And then big old bump on her behind. So she's not in a good way. This is a great time, though, to bring up is like how wonderful it is to see how each production decides to do Milky White.
Yes.
Where sometimes it's just a cow you're wheeling out that doesn't move. Sometimes it's people in a cow costume. Sometimes it's a puppet that people are using. And I'm all for it. I'm all for like different variations of Milky White. But the newest performance, the newest production that was on Broadway, which I did get to go and see, that was the all-star. Milky White for me was the all-star. The puppetry on display there was Kennedy Kanagawa, I think.
Yes.
Was the puppeteer. Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't get to see it in person, but I've seen like the clips online and at the Tony Awards and all that stuff that they did, and it does look just brilliant the way they handled that.
How does the junior version do Milky White?
And that's another thing. Like they'll put suggestions in them because sometimes the juniors are made to be, you know, they give you the whole kit so that essentially it can go to somebody like me who works at a regional theater and we can do it, but it can also go to your elementary school math teacher who's never done theater before, and they can kind of muddy their way through it, and they have a lot of the tools they need. So sometimes they'll explain things, and I don't even remember if they suggest what they might have in their director's notebook, like suggestions of what you can do for the cow generally. And I did this too, have a student play it because it just gives another role.
Yeah.
In my case, I had two students play it. I had one play the head and one play the end, so that it kind of gives two kids a chance, but it also gave them moments to play off of each other. When we did the later on in the show, when they have the fake cow comes out, they switched parts, so who was playing the rump then played the head of that cow, and they put on a slightly different looking costume, and you know, so we had a little fun with that sort of thing. And we had moments like in It Takes Two where they could separate and dance around with the baker and his wife. So you know, in my world, that's nice because it gives two more roles or more to kids to do.
As a quick aside, I've never felt more like a kid being told Santa Claus isn't real than when James Lapine said how they did the witch transformation in the original production.
Yeah.
which is, I never know that, like, whoever was, like, it was Bernadette, obviously, for the first couple of months. She didn't actually stay with the production all that long in the original run. But whoever took, it was a body double. It was just like, it's not her in that one section. And then they flip it around, so it is her. Prettified sort of thing. I'm like, oh, I never knew that it was a body double that was coming out.
Yeah, and it's such the simplest trick. And it's like, well,
simple.
Then and you feel a little dumb, like, why didn't I think of that? Well, the other thing I didn't think about either is when they're talking about, I think on that other podcast where they're talking about filming that, how, you know, since Lapine was directing it, how, and they did, and again, it was one of those things of, well, of course they did that. Like how they made her makeup maybe a little more intricate. They were able to do cutting and stuff stuff. So the effect was a little different on the PBS than it was actually on stage too, because they had more of the magic and it could put more special effects and stuff into it because they were doing like pickup shots. And I'm like, well, duh. Yeah. Why didn't I think? I'm watching it all these years being like, how did they get it so perfect in live? And it's like, oh, they didn't.
The trick is that they didn't. Yeah. So we now get into like really the main theme of this prologue. It's taken us this long, and here it is. So Little Red Riding Hood is the one who gets to say, "Into the woods, it's time to go. I hate to leave. I have to, though. Into the woods, it's time, and so I must begin my journey. Into the woods and through the trees to where I am expected, ma'am. Into the woods to grandmother's house." She grabs another cookie. "Into the woods to grandmother's house." And the wife asks, "You're certain of your way? The way is clear. The light is good. I have no fear, nor no one should. The woods are just trees. The trees are just wood. I sort of hate to ask it, but do you have a basket?" And the baker is like, "Don't stay and be late." Then the wife says, "And save some of those sweets for granny. Into the woods and down the dell, the path is straight, I know it well. Into the woods and who can tell what's waiting on the journey? Into the woods to bring some bread to granny, who is sick in bed, never can tell what lies ahead, for all that I know she's already dead. But into the woods, into the woods, into the woods, to grandmother's house and home before dark.
Into the woods, it's time to go, I hate to leave, I have to though. Into the woods, it's time and so I must begin my journey. Into the woods and through the trees to where I am expected, ma'am. Into the woods to grandmother's house. Into the woods to grandmother's house.
Are you certain of your way?
The way is clear, the light is good. I have no fear, nor no one should. The woods are just trees, the trees are just wood. I sort of hate to ask it, but do you have a basket?
Yes, we do.
I don't suppose you're planning on buying any of these.
Oh, shh, now. Don't stray and be late, all right?
You might save some of those sweets for Granny. Oh, my. She's a thief!
Into the woods and down the dell, the path is straight, I know it well. Into the woods and who can tell what's waiting on the journey? Into the woods to bring some bread to Granny, who was sick in bed. Never can tell what lies ahead, for all that I know she's already dead. But into the woods, into the woods, into the woods, to grandmother's house and home before dark.
Just even from the start, you know, already introducing the word good, which comes to play right. Much bigger and later on in the show. So one thing that I find interesting about the show, each time that I've worked on it in my life or been exposed to it, this is one of those shows that just grows with you. And the older I get, the different, each step in my life, I've taken different things from it. So when I was in high school, you know, when I was in high school, I saw things one way. It's like a 15, 16 year old. But then early in my directing career, I directed a version of it. It was literally my wife and I were working on it together. At the time, we were about to be married, a month away from being married. And we were bickering so much that the cast told me later, they're like, "We didn't know if you guys were going to make it or not, you know." But I see things from things I focused on in that one when I was, you know, 20 something, early 20s. Then last year working on it again, and now at the point I was working on it last year, you know, now I have a kid. After many years, my wife and I, you know, really did struggle with having a child. Then I have, you know, at the time he was almost four at the time. Both of my parents had passed away by that point. You know, so many more themes now seeing it as an adult. And I say all that by way of saying, back when I first was, you know, into the show, and I say this with all love and all due respect, because Danielle Ferland does such a brilliant job on that. But, you know, especially when I'm first watching, I'm like, man, she is annoying, which again is the point, is the purpose of it. And you know, we talked already about Joanna Gleason being brilliant and Barbara Byrne being brilliant and Burnett and all these iconic. But, you know, under the radar is her performance as Little Red, Danielle Ferland, because like she is just so tone perfect, because it's so hard to play an annoying character and play it annoying without really truly being like, you know, fingernails on the chalkboard annoying. She gets close.
That fine line.
Yeah, she gets close, but she, you know, and especially how young she actually was at the time doing it too. And like, you know, and so now, you know, reading it as you're, you know, saying the lines, how well, like the Little Red Riding Hood journey too is one that is a very fascinating one in the show, and what happens to her and how she responds to her trauma. And you already see, like, you know, thinking of that and looking at this now, how sing-songy this is, how much of a little kid she really is, how really naive she really is, but also
the naivety is like the biggest point here, right?
Because
her journey throughout this is becoming, going from naive to, like, I don't know, streetwise. I don't know
hardened.
How else to harden and stuff like that stuff, right? Like, it is quite the journey that she goes on, where it's like, I think someone could write, talking about theses or theses, the way is clear, the light is good, I have no fear, nor no one should. I think you could just deconstruct those four lines and how those change.
Right.
Because I think that in her view, that is absolutely 100% right. But we learn, and she learns, that having a little bit of fear is actually not a bad thing.
Right.
It shouldn't consume you, but, like, having fear does, like, you know, help save you. And even that line, the light is good. Again, we can deconstruct what good means and whether or not we think shedding light on certain things is good.
And, well, I mean, and even, yeah, and again, like, drawing the line to her later song, light is good, you know, I know things now, you know, like, she, when she is exposed to light, what does that do to her? When she is, you know, exposed to more knowledge, is that good? Was that a good thing? And what is good? Yeah, it's really, and again, you know, until you're really looking at the lyrics, you know, in the nature of the show, there's just all the little funny business that she's doing throughout this, of stealing the treats
and stealing all the treats and
fighting
stuff.
Them and she's doing no good, you know, and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And so you do miss all of just this little setup that's in here for everything else, which is, you know, this is like our big theme. Here we are. It's amazing.
All right. So we flash back here, we cut away to Cinderella, who goes, fly birds, back to the sky, back to the eaves and the leaves and the fields. And then her stepsisters come in and hurry up and do my hair. Cinderella, are you really wearing that? Here I found a little tear. Cinderella, can you hide it with a hat? And Cinderella goes, you look beautiful. I know. She means me. Put it in a twist. And then Cinderella goes, mother said be good, father said be nice. That was always their advice. So be nice, Cinderella. Good, Cinderella. Nice, good, nice. Tighter. What's the good of being good if everyone is blind and you're always left behind? Never mind, Cinderella. Kind, Cinderella. Nice, good, nice. Kind, good, nice. And she pulls too tight on the hair and she goes, gets slapped in the face. And she said, and her stepsister says, not that tight, Claude.
Fly, birds, back to the sky. Back to the eaves and the leaves and the fields and the...
Hurry up and do my hair, Cinderella. Are you really wearing that?
Here I found a little tear, Cinderella. Can't you hide it with a hat?
You look beautiful.
I know.
She means me.
Put it in a twist.
Who will be there?
Mother said be good. Father said be nice. That was always their advice. So be nice, Cinderella. Good, Cinderella. Nice, good, nice.
Tighter.
What's the good of being good if everyone is blind and you're always left behind? Never mind, Cinderella. Kind, Cinderella. Nice, good, nice. Kind, good, nice.
Not that tight.
Sorry.
Claude.
Nice is different than good, but this is what Cinderella was told to be her entire life.
And even with that, again, it's undercut through, you know, she's talking about mother should be good, father should be nice, you know, so be nice. And meanwhile, she is, like, kind of manhandling her sisters,
right.
But or stepsisters, but it's also a response to their meanness and their nastiness to her as well. So again, yeah, we're already seeing this. Well, yeah, you think you're being good, or you're pretending to be good, but there's this undercurrent already happening. There's also your reaction to them, and all of that is tying in already, which is, you know, really, really cool to see seeing it laid out like this without all the stage business too. It's really pretty, you know, clear. And even with her ending with nice, good, nice, kind, good, nice, there we have kind in there. We have, you know, so yeah, all these little threads that are going to, you know, come to fruition later on in the show.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things I took away even at my first viewing when I was watching this as a teenager, of how words that I think sometimes we believe are synonyms to one another do have slightly different meanings. And I think when we get to that point in Little Red Song of, like, nice being different than good, for whatever reason, I still, like, it really was this, like, switch that flipped on me. as me being like the eternal people pleaser that I've always been my entire life, it's like, no, sometimes being nice is not actually being nice. And you have to stand up for yourself, or you have to like say what it is that you actually want. That is different than actually doing, going out and doing good things. Like there is a completely different interpretation of those words, sort of thing. So for some reason, it's really been this deep dive that I really even internalized that Cinderella is talking about the same thing here in this opening song. I think it's easy to overlook this, that she's setting this up, these themes up are being said right here in the opening.
Yeah, and really, you know, not even connecting the dots even until now about how Red was just talking about light is good, and then a second later we have Cinderella talking about good. I never even really made that clear of a journey before between the two, just side by side already.
So now we get the introduction of the witch. So the witch comes in and like knocks on the door, and the baker's like, oh, it's the witch from next door. And she comes in and she states, in the past, you were no more than a babe. Your father brought his young wife and you to this cottage. They were a handsome couple, but not handsome neighbors. You see, your mother was with child, and she had developed an unusual appetite. She took one look at my beautiful garden and told your father that what she wanted more than anything in the world was greens, greens, and nothing but greens. Parsley, peppers, cabbages, and celery, asparagus, and watercress, and fiddle ferns, and lettuce. He said, all right, but it wasn't quite, because I caught him in the autumn in my garden one night. He was robbing me, raping me, rooting through my rutabaga, raiding my arugula, and ripping up the rampion, my champion, my favorite. I should have laid a spell on him right there. Could have turned him into a stone, or a dog, or a chair, or a... But I let him have the rampion and lots to spare. In return, however, I said, fair is fair. You can let me have the baby that your wife will bear, and we'll call it square. I had a brother? No. But you had a sister.
Who might that be?
It's the witch from next door.
The old enchantress told the couple she had placed a spell on their house.
What spell?
In the past, when your mother was with child, she developed an unusual appetite. She took one look at my beautiful garden and told your father that what she wanted more than anything in the world was greens, greens, and nothing but greens. Parsley, peppers, cabbages, and celery, asparagus, and watercress, and fiddle ferns, and lettuce. He said, all right, but it wasn't quite, 'cause I caught him in the autumn in my garden one night. He was robbing me, raping me, rooting through my rutabaga, raiding my arugula, and ripping up the rampion, and my champion, my favorite. I should have laid a spell on him right there. Could have turned him into stone, or a dog, or a chair. But I let him have the rampion and lots to spare. In return, however, I said, fair is fair. You can let me have the baby that your wife will bear. And we'll call it square.
I had a brother?
No. But you had a sister.
All right, well, the witch's rap, quote unquote.
I know.
Which in that conversation
and
piece,
I'm pretty sure I nailed it. So
you were awesome. You were brilliant. I can hear in my head again the
and when people think rap, they automatically think the guy who hosts Putting It Together, that guy's the best rapper.
That's who we gotta turn to. Yeah. Well, and I love in that conversation piece with Sondheim when he gets to this, and he goes, it's referred to as the witch's rap. It is not a rap. He very clearly is like,
I know it's not
a rap.
Some people will claim that he like Into the Woods, like had the first rap on Broadway. I don't know. Like I kind of agree with Sondheim a little bit in this way. Like definitely there's a rhythm to it. It's more rhythmic than it is like melodic going on here. So yes, if you want to argue it in that way, but, yeah, I wouldn't really call this a rap
pattern.
Either.
It's a true pattern song, pattern, you know. Yeah. And I think probably what it lends to is not only the time frame it came out, but also the orchestration, the arrangement didn't do that any favors to dismissing the idea of it being a rap, where they put it in that you know mid 80s Casio.
True.
Always amuses me. It's so cheesy, and it's so like, and again, as a younger man, I was just like rolling eyes. Oh God, I like this, but but I don't like this. But yeah. Now I look at it, it's just like, it's cute, it's amusing. And I think lends it to that. But yeah, I mean, you talk about a mouthful, and again, they were saying how, like, with those earlier scenes, they could just do the, you know, quick cuts, no squeeze pal and all that sort of stuff in between, because you get the gist of those stories. But mm-hmm. now that we're introducing this new story, we don't know as well, because even with, you know, the Rapunzel story, the witch's involvement, even in the original, I think the Perrault version is the more commonly known Rapunzel story, you know, that this is basically the story. This is basically the Rapunzel story, but people still are not very commonly known.
Even in the Grimm's version, the Rapunzel storyline is a couple, wife wants the stuff from the garden, he right. goes, grabs it, and then she says, and it is a witch, and the witch says, great, but I have to get your baby in return, and then that's Rapunzel. Which, by the way, I just wanted to point out, I this is, again, I'm embarrassing, but I'm going to put myself out there. I only learned this week, because I looked it up, that Rampion, the other name for Rampion, is Rapunzel.
Like, yes, that is... I wrote an adaptation of the story years ago, and I was surprised to discover that, too. And going to this, and in this version of it, yeah, they don't have the witch from next door line from the baker.
No, they don't write it in the book, but yeah, they don't have it comes right before this.
But I wanted to touch on that, because for one thing, it is just I was focusing on that this time, where it's like, I just sort of took it as nature, like, oh yeah, it's the witch from next door. But that is a funny line. That is a funny, like, kind of toss off the way they do it. But it's also a great way of just like, okay, you're already, now you're into the story where the audience is like, yeah, witches exist, magic exists in the story. Let's just move on. It's not a big deal. It's just the witch from next door.
Which is why I have this slight disagreement with the creators of this show. So who am I to cast this version still opine and Sonic? But both of them have come out and said, like, the core to the baker and his wife is the fact that they are essentially like modern day people from Brooklyn or the Bronx put into a fantasy setting that they've just woken up inside of. But I don't know. I never really get that sense, because they do take all these fantasy elements at face value sort of thing. They're not like, oh my gosh, I'm in this magical world sort of thing. They might talk like not fairy tale characters and stuff like that, but they're very much inside of a fantasy world.
So much of that to me almost feels retconned based on the Chip Zine and Joanna Gleason performances, because they are both so dry and so like, you know, Upper East Side kind of, like, their speech patterns and very kind of normal, you know, normal, quote unquote. But like in the actual text itself, it's not so much, you know, with the Chip Zine of it all. I definitely want to point out, like, his hilarious kind of insinuation or his take on what the witch next door represents, based on the infamous stories of Stephen Sondheim's neighbor, who happened to be Catherine Hepburn.
Catherine Hepburn.
and they both told these stories, and how they both really did not get along too well, because I guess she was working on the show Coco and had all these, like, you know, rehearsals and stuff early in the day. And he was working, Sondheim was there, they were neighbors and they kind of shared a backyard almost in where they were. He was working on Company and had everybody over and was like playing some songs from Company, and it was going late into the night. And in one of their tellings of it, she climbed up like the trellis by his house or something, banged on the window, it was raining, she was drenched, he opened the door, she yelled at him, young man, it's too late to be playing your music and all that. And years later, Chip was working on a show, in a movie with her. She was telling him, oh, I have this young man who plays music and he plays all hours and it's crazy and all this sort of stuff. And he wakes me up and I try and get him. And then when he was at Sondheim working on this, I think Sondheim mentioned, oh, you know, do you know who my neighbor is? And he's like, yeah, actually I do. And he's like, yeah, one night she banged on my window and she was like drenched and yelling at me. And like, you know, I guess there's another story of her pressing her nose against the window one night and Sondheim looked over and she just glared. So Chip Zine's take is that, like, the witch from next door is like kind of Sondheim's subtle little jab at, you know,
I really want someone's take to be like Catherine Hepburn's voice witch.
And I was looking up on it because I didn't want to bring that up and speak out of school, but there was a hilarious stuff online where they said that, like, she was filming some documentary, and this was later on, which is hilarious, is after Into the Woods, but like this, she was doing some documentary or something in the early 90s, and she had a documentary crew over, And they had to film her like moving out and going to Connecticut and their usual things. And she would always collect all of her like flowers and stuff and go into the car. And she collected all these flowers. And then she got in the car and she had her assistant. She's like, oh, yes. And remind me to tell, you know, we have to return those flowers to my neighbor after. And she's like, what do you mean? She's like, well, all we had was like yellows and pinks, and they wouldn't show up too well on camera. So I stole his red geraniums that he had, and I thought that would look better. And it was Sondheim, and his assistant came out and was like, what are you doing? She's like, oh, we'll return these. And she, you know, and there's an image, this article is reading, of her walking from this documentary with the red flowers. So like, not only was she the witch from next door, but actually was in a reverse stealing flowers from him, you know, after Into the Woods was written. So like, yeah, just hilarious. So now I can't really see it. That I want to see someone do there, like Kate Hepburn as the witch now. But yeah, but again, way off tangent, sorry. all of this stuff in here though, and like just the listing, and you know, Sondheim of course is infamous
great
for
internal rhymes here.
Yeah, Sondheim hating his list songs, but when he does a list song, man, can that guy do a list song?
The great one that I want to call out. This is not an internal rhyme, but an actual rhyme that he's doing. But like, autumn rhyming with autumn, like
yes, kind of
sneaks up on you.
Yeah, it really does. And when he gets into that whole section of, you know, I mean, I'm a sucker for alliteration. So when we're getting into the robbing, raping, rooting, rutabaga, raiding, arugula, ripping up the rampion, you know, all that, like, man, that is just, that must have been a fun day for him when he was just like, ooh, another R.
I do want to push back on one element here of this list here, and I don't know, I feel like maybe I'm being too apologetic, or I don't know what the right word is here. I mean, too much of a white knight, maybe that's the right term, but does he need to have raping me in this? Like, is that really what's going on here? I mean,
I've always wondered that too. Raping felt a little bit, it's kind of like going to the Fantastics and they have that song, The Rape, and all that, and it's like,
yeah,
you know, maybe the context, but again, he was 86-87, he was writing this, the context was very well established, and I've always thought, whereas raiding, r-a-i-d-i-n-g, would work just as well. There, you know, it's the same idea without the other connotations. But again, when you get into him wanting to be very upfront with, you know, some of the sexual, you know, subtext and the sexual violence that's going to come into play, you know, later on in the show,
extremely overt, but I mean, again, getting to like Little Red and some of the other, and then how the princes act, and like we're getting to that without actually showing it on stage. So it is seeding that idea into the
without showing it until we see the wolf's costume in the original.
That is true. that is true.
And which again apparently was a Sondheim like suggestion and pushing for, where, and so, you know, you sort of see maybe he is wanting to push the envelope a little bit and wanting raping to again be setting again. Yeah, it's not it's not overt, but it doesn't take much scratching below the surface to see like what is really being intended with some of this the subtext here. But I'm with you on that. It's like, you know it just kind of makes me cringe a little bit these days, especially.
We continue on, the narrator going, however, the witch refused to tell him any more of his sister, not even that her name was Rapunzel. The witch goes, I thought I had been more than reasonable, and that we all might live happily ever after. But how was I to know what your father had also hidden in his pocket? You see, when I had inherited that garden, my mother had warned me I would be punished if I were ever to lose any of the beans. Beans? The special beans. I let him go. I didn't know he'd stolen my beans. I was watching him crawl back over the wall, and then bang, crash, the lightning flash, and well, that's another story, never mind. Anyway, at last the big day came. I made my claim. Oh, don't take away the baby, they shrieked and screeched, but they did, and I hid her where she'll never be reached. And your father cried, and your mother died, when for extra measure, I admit it was a pleasure, I said, sorry, I'm still not mollified, and I laid a little spell on them. You too, son, that your family tree would always be a barren one. So there's no more fuss and there's no more scenes, and my garden thrives. You should see my nectarines. And I'm telling you the same I tell kings and queens, don't ever, never, ever mess around with my greens, especially the beans.
But the witch refused to tell him any more of his sister, not even that her name was Rapunzel.
I thought that I had been more than reasonable, and that we all might be able to live happily ever after. How was I to know what your father had also hidden in his pocket? You see, when I inherited that garden, my mother warned me that I would be punished if I ever were to lose any of the beans? The special beans. I let him go. I didn't know he'd stolen my beans. I was watching him crawl back over the wall, and then bang, crash, and a lightning flash. Well, that's another story. Never mind. Anyway, the big day came, and I made my claim. Oh, don't take away the baby. They shrieked and screeched, but I didn't. I hit her where she'll never be reached. Your father cried. Your mother died. Went for extra measure. I admit it was a pleasure. I said, sorry, I'm still not qualified. And I laid a little spell on them. You too, son. That your family tree would always be a barren one! So there's no more fuss and there's no more scenes, and my garden thrives. You should see my nectarines, but I'm telling you the same I tell kings and queens. Don't ever, never, ever mess around with my greens. Especially the beans.
Yeah, so now we have the introduction of our bean theme in the background. Mm-hmm. The, you know, da, 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 you know, yeah. Starts creeping its way in.
The five beans, too, when she brings them out later on, like those five notes are what kind of go throughout the entire score and then sometimes get inverted in the score depending on what we're doing. Yeah.
And then the theme is a big part of her theme too, with the, you know, stay with me, the da 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 da, you know, very overtly there. The weaving in of that here. So now we have the introduction of the beans, which factors into everything else going forward. The first part of this that really struck me too, maybe really even for the first time, is now how clearly parenting is such a big theme of the show too.
For
and
sure.
Up to this point, we've heard how the baker and his wife, you know, don't have a child. You know, Cinderella talks about her mother. Jack has his mother right there. Red
the baker
is
influenced
about,
by his father. Like, there's
yes, his father. Red has talked about her grandmother and mother, you know, and, you know, mother said, don't stray and be late and all that. And now the witch is talking about her own mother. My mother warned me. So, you know, we have all of these little things about parenting or lack of parenting or all of those themes already being introduced into here as well. And just the buildup of this story that she's telling is so dramatic and so well done, mm-hmm. beyond, you know, even the you know, the performance and everything of it is just the way it just keeps like building up and building and building and building. And they still have moments for the little asides and, you know, well, that's another story. Never mind. Anyway, you know,
yeah,
that's
funny. Yeah.
which is a great segue. I do that all the time when as you can hear, I'm a bit of a rambler sometimes. So, you know, if I ramble, it could go into, well, that's another story. Never mind. Anyway, yeah, it's a very great segue.
That's a little bit more malevity. I will say too about the witch. This is the other part that I love to see other people's interpretations of it, because I do think it's important to have her be somewhat scary in these moments. You do have to feel like there is a threat here, but there is an interesting like sliding scale where people will lean a little bit more into like the daffiness of the witch in some cases, and then some will like really lean in into the menace of the witch. Once again, not good or bad, is an interpretation that you want to do. Mm-hmm. This is where I have kind of I will say this, I don't know how a hot take this is, but I recently watched the Into the Woods, the Regent Park version. This is also up on YouTube, and I love Hannah Waddingham's performance as the witch. Like, love it. But she is like terrifying in this role for a lot of it.
Yeah, because I'd seen the Donna Murphy version of it, the reversion of it that they did in Central Park, and Donna Murphy's take is she makes the daffiness still be menacing, like almost she's having some sort of a fit when she does the stuff.
Oh yeah.
And it's terrifying, you know. But yeah, the Hannah Waddingham, and for those, you know, who are, you know, Ted Lasso fans, she plays Rebecca on that. And I, you know, like most people, I first knew her through there. I didn't know she had a deep theater career until after seeing her on Ted Lasso. And then, yeah, she in that performance and her Stay With Me and all is just brilliant, you know. And
yeah, I like it a lot.
Yeah, I do too. I agree.
We skipped over that part back in there where she says she could have turned him into stone or a dog or a chair or a So there's no actual word there is what I'm trying to say.
Right.
However, everyone does this differently. Like every performance, every recording has this done differently where some just don't say it at all. It says they just end on chair. That's how the Bernadette Peters version is.
Mm-hmm.
Some do have like the actual fit that Bernadette does on stage. If you watch the PBS version, like she has like an actual like fit on stage at this point. And some do actually say snake. They just sing snake in that
point, yeah.
in that spot. So anyways, again, another thing that people can have, I guess, a little bit of free reign on what they do there.
Yeah, and I guess ultimately it's, again, just like that chord at the beginning of the show, it's just more meant to be unsettling than anything else, than mm-hmm. you know, you, because you have the story going on, but then you do have this little sense of like, okay, what is going on here, and do we have a true mad person? And I guess you could also play it as she's purposely trying to set them off and purposely trying to, you know, play Daffy or play, you know, whatever, right, as an unsettling move.
Back when I was a teenager, this is what taught me what the word mollified meant, so, which is great, great for my vocabulary. Okay, so we move on. We're back here to Jack here this time. Again, this is where she's trying to encourage him to go and sell the cow. He's not listening very well, so he thinks he's trying to get less than five. And then the mother finally sings, Jack, 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 head in a sack. The house is getting colder. This is not a time for dreaming. Chimney stack. Starting to crack, the mics are getting bolder, the floor is gone slack, your mother's getting older, your father's not back, and you can't just sit here dreaming pretty dreams. To wish and wait from day to day will never keep the wolves away. So into the woods the time is now, we have to live, I don't care how. Into the woods to sell the cow, you must begin the journey. Straight through the woods and don't delay, we have to face the marketplace. Into the woods to journey's end. And Jack goes into the woods to sell a friend.
Now listen to me, Jack. Lead Milky White to market and fetch the best price that you can. Take no less than £5. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Now how much are you to ask?
No more than £5.
Less than five.
Less than five.
Jack, 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 head in a sack. The house is getting colder. This is not a time for dreaming. Chimney stack, starting to crack. The mice are getting bolder, the floor's gone slack. Your mother's getting older, your father's not back. And you can't just sit here dreaming pretty dreams. To wish and wait from day to day will never keep the wolves away. So into the woods, the time is now, we have to live, I don't care how. Into the woods to sell the cow, you must begin the journey. Straight through the woods and don't delay, we have to face the marketplace. Into the woods to journey's end.
Into the woods to sell a friend.
Oh, someday you'll have a real pet, Jack.
A piggy!
Well, and now we have the realization of what we heard as underscoring before in the Jack, Jack, Jack theme that right. She sings here. Going back to what they were saying about, Sondheim was saying about like the little propulsive moments that go through all the, you know, the dun 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 dun, 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 dun throughout yeah. everything. But how, you know, he said to really pay attention though to, you know, how you play it in each of the different sections, so that the whole thing, if the whole 15 minutes was played with the exact same enthusiasm or exact same like energy behind it, it would get dull very quickly where you're getting
exactly.
repetitive.
And so peaks and valleys. Hearing,
yeah. And so coming off of the highs of the witches thing, you still have that little bit of propulsion and like a bum 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 bum, you know, mm-hmm. is in there, but it yeah brings you back a little bit before we get back into the, you know, the Into the Woods main theme coming up. So it is just a nice moment. It's always hard. Jack's mother is always hard to get a read on her of like, you know,
right.
Because again, parenting is questionable all throughout this show. And she's really, I guess at this point, she's the only direct parent we actually see, because we see stepmother, we're hearing about parents, we're hearing about the other yeah. parents, but now we're actually seeing some parenting, questionable kind of parenting at play. And looking at some of this, to wish and wait from day to day will never keep the wolves away, you know, in some ways it's like, yes, admirable, yes, you know, you can't just wish away your life, you have to go and take some action. But as we've already seen, she doesn't think a lot of her son, so she is kind of pushing him into the wolves and almost knowingly pushing him in. So, yeah. you know, yeah, it just opens up some just interesting like points about her and how materialistic is she? And we're going to see quite a lot later on.
Well, it's a difference between active and passive wishing, right? Like I wish mm-hmm. that you know, I can achieve this thing, so I'm going to go out and on my quest to do this thing that I wish to have happen, versus like, oh, it'd be really cool if this thing happened and is sitting at home and not doing anything. So she's the one who's like pushing him out of the nest, so to speak. This section is the only section in the movie that they cut out completely, which is interesting to me. Where as far as like this opening section goes, they basically keep everything as is, except for like the whole Jack, Jack, Jack up until the wolves, to keep the wolves away. And I kind of get the fact of like, oh, fine, like we don't need like the house is falling apart, etc. We can see that the house is falling apart.
True.
Of things. That makes sense. I wish they just kept that final one. Tuition wait from day to day will never keep the wolves away. And then she goes into so into the woods you go sort of thing. Because again, it just underscores a lot of the themes that this show is going to explore. And it tells us about Jack too, that he's being pushed more into the woods than he is being going out on an adventure.
Yeah. And again, that theme that we were talking about with Little Red, her naivete and how naive she is. I mean, there's nobody who's more naive than Jack, you know, and yes. Barry. And so, again, it's that whole thing of like pushing him out there. You know, Red is naive, but she has her false bravado. Like Jack's got nothing. Right. Jack's got like nothing behind him.
Yeah. We've told him before. He's a dim-witted dummy.
His best friend's a cow, you know.
Yeah.
And he doesn't even know the gender, you know. But again, yeah, the little weaving in again. Now we have, there are wolves out there. We're going to see a wolf, not in his story, but there are wolves out there. We know the wolves are out there. Jumping way back, you know, I was struck this time. I never even really caught it how much when Cinderella's doing her old thing about like kind, good, you know, all that. Yeah. And she talks about being blind. And it's like, oh, yeah, her stepsisters get blinded later on.
Become blind. Yeah.
Yeah. So
and Rapunzel's prince becomes blind. There's a lot of blindness too in this.
There's a lot of blind, yeah. And a lot of willful blindness, I guess, too, you could say too. So yeah, so all of these little themes, all these little, you know, breadcrumbs, beans, if you will, are being planted that we're gonna see later on.
This is the next part here is where we get the actual quest given to us. So the narrator says, meanwhile, the witch, for purposes of her own, explained how the baker might lift the spell. You wish to have the curse reversed? I'll need a certain potion first. Go to the wood and bring me back 1, the cow is white as milk. 2, the cape is red as blood. 3, the hair is yellow as corn. 4, the slipper is pure as gold. Bring me these before the chime of midnight in 3 days' time, and you shall have, I guarantee, a child as perfect as child can be. Go to the wood. And then she disappears.
You wish to have the curse reversed? I'll need a certain potion first. Go to the wood and bring me back 1, the cow as white as milk. 2, the cape as red as blood. 3, the hair as yellow as corn. 4, the slipper as pure as gold. Bring me these before the chime of midnight. In 3 days' time, 'tis then the blue moon reappears, which comes but once each 100 years. Bring them, and I guarantee a child as perfect as child can be. Go to the wood!
Yeah, well, now we have what do they call it, in like the call to action, the
yes, that's right,
you know, the hero's journey thing for the baker and his wife, and you know, and yeah, setting up now. Here's what we have to do. We're what, maybe 10 minutes into the show now, and now we have our action going. But again, all of that was so important to lay in all of, you know, what's going to happen, because there are, you know, they're all separated now, but they are about to wind in, you know, and you know, going to the larger, you know, there's so many themes to the show, but one of the biggest ones about community and how, you know, act one, everybody is basically separated until they start coming together. And then how act two is so much.
Yeah, that's all. The community is a big part of this show as well, as Sondheim talks about.
Yes. So, you know, this is the first laying in of, if you are just watching all of this cold for the first time, of, you know, you see in 10 minutes or so of all these different characters, but now you see cow is white as milk, cape is red as blood, all of that stuff is coming in.
Well, I think that the cool thing too about these ingredients is, like, again, as an audience member, I guess, unless you're completely oblivious, I think that, like, you know, straight up, like, oh, I know what all the four things are, right?
Right.
Because it's like, the cow is white as milk. We've already been introduced to Milky White the cow. Like, obviously, that's what the cow. The cape is red as blood. We just saw the Little Red Riding Hood. Obviously, that's what the cape is going to be. The hair is yellow as corn. We've talked about Rapunzel already here further back. That has to be the hair. Mm-hmm. And then the slipper is pure as gold. We know, as an audience, that if it's a slipper, it has to be Cinderella. We've already been introduced to Cinderella. We know what that story looks like. So it's like, oh, we're like a little bit ahead of these characters. We know how this is all going to work together, sort of thing.
Yeah, and again, it really definitely speaks, not only was, you know, Sondheim such a big movie nerd, but he was definitely a puzzle nerd. And adding in together the gamesmanship of like the caper movies, or also the, well, like his Last of Sheila, you know, the murder mystery sort of thing. And they always talk about when writing those things and creating those things, there are certain things that you want to introduce to let the audience feel smart and let them feel that they're ahead of the game. And yet, like you said, seeing all this, you're like, oh, well, I know what the red cape is. I know. And, you know,
we don't know how they're going to get them necessarily, but we know what it is that they're going after.
Exactly. And it's a way of empowering the audience to feel a little smarter. You're feeling smarter than the baker and his wife right now. Cause you know, maybe they know the red cape, but they don't know anything else yet. Yeah. So you're feeling ahead of things, but again, they're going to keep twisting this and pulling you back. But it helps you as an audience member lean forward and now feel part of the story, which is pretty smart.
So we go back to Cinderella here, and the stepmother says, ladies, our carriage awaits. And Cinderella comes with the lentils that she's gotten out of the fireplace. Now may I go to the festival? The festival? Darling, those nails. Darling, those clothes. Lentils are one thing, but darling, with those, you'd make us the fools of the festival and mortify the prince. And Cinderella's father walks by her. And she says, good night, father. And he's like, muh. Cinderella sings once more, I wish.
Ladies, our carriage waits.
Now may I go to the festival?
The festival? Darling, those nails, darling, those clothes. Lentils are one thing, but darling, with those, you'd make us the fools of the festival and mortify the prince.
The carriage is waiting.
We must be gone.
Good night, father.
Good night.
I wish.
I like how the father grumbles. I always like how he grumbles.
They don't want to sleep on the introduction of the father and his grumbling, his drunkenness, as it can be played sometimes. Even just seeing now, you know, the difference between, because by this point in the show, the stepmother and the sisters are fabulous and done up. And as you said, you know, conventionally attractive and not like the ugly stepsisters. And we get to see them go off, and we still see Cinderella as she is and as she's going to be left behind. And another little pulling back. We just had the, the drama of the witch. And now it's kind of pulling back the story a little, or the energy back a little bit before we get into the final bit of this prologue.
That's right. Adds in that little bit that her father is completely distant from her at this point. In the Grimm's fairy tale, he's very anti his own daughter. Which is interesting. And in this one, he seems more either like unaware or just uninvested type of thing, or drunk and just like out of his mind. Like he's just not in his right state of mind.
And, you know, I forgot in the movie how the movie doesn't have time for him at all. They just kill him off too. They say Cinderella's parents are both gone. And it's like, oh,
that's right.
Okay.
We have no time for any extra characters. So we come back to the baker. The baker finds his father's beans in the old hunting jacket that he used to have. And the wife is like, well, I should come along on your journey. He's like, no, you are not coming. And the wife goes, I know you are fearful of the woods at night. The baker goes, the spell is on my house. Only I can lift the spell. The spell is on my house. No, the spell is on our house. We must lift the spell together. The spell is on our house. No, you are not to come, and that is final. Now, what am I to return with? You don't remember? The cow is white as milk. The cape is red as blood. The hair is yellow as corn. The slipper is pure as gold. And the baker trying to memorize it. The cow is white as milk. The cape is red as blood. The hair is yellow as gold. Sorry, the hair is yellow as corn, the slipper is pure as gold. And the narrator ends off, and so the baker reluctantly set off to meet the enchantress's demands. As for Cinderella, and we'll get to Cinderella here in a moment.
Look what I found in father's hunting jacket.
6 beans.
I wonder if they are the
witch's beans. We'll take them with us.
No, you are not coming.
I know you are fearful of the woods at night.
The spell is on my house. Only I can lift the spell.
No,
the spell
no,
is
the
on
spell
my
is on
house.
Our house.
No, you are not to come, and that is final. Then what am I to return with?
You don't remember? The cow is white as milk, the cape is red as blood, the hair is yellow as corn, the slipper is pure as gold.
The cow is white as milk, the cape is red as blood, the hair is yellow as corn, the slipper is pure as gold.
And so the baker set off to meet the witch's demands. As for Cinderella,
I still wish to go to the festival.
Well, now, and you know, again, all due respect, now is like the clunkiest part maybe of the book. Hey, look what I just found in this jacket.
I know, it just happens to be here.
But it's a fairy tale. And by this point, now you know there are witches. Now you know there are spells. Now you know sure. There are curses.
There's going to be magic beans. Yeah.
You don't even think about it. Yeah, you're just like, well, of course he just found them. Seeing the interplay of the two of them here, and even musically when they start overlapping, you know, no, the spell is on my on our house, and she's overlapping with him. And, you know, in just those little touches, because you haven't seen a lot of, you've seen them just reacting to others. They've just been reacting to Little Red, reacting to
right.
The witch.
Right, maybe see them together, yeah.
And now you see what their interplay is, and already the little bit of tension that's between them, you know, my house, no, our house, you know, and how that's going to fracture, but then come together, but then fracture throughout the rest of the show. Yeah. And you
I think
start
it sets
seeing
up nicely too. Like, yeah, it sets up nicely. It takes two later on.
Yes.
Show too, when they have that moment, it's like, actually, no, we do have to work together. We can't just do this as individuals. We can be better together.
Yeah. And again, community, you know, act one community, is about, yeah. You know, act one is about my house. Act two becomes about our house.
Yes.
Which, you know, is, you know, yeah. Another great way to look at it, I think.
So Cinderella is singing, I still wish to go to the festival, but how am I ever to get to the festival? And the baker's still trying to remember it. The cow is white as milk, the cape is red as blood, the hair is yellow as corn. And the wife goes, the slipper is pure as gold. I know, and this is Cinderella again, I know, I'll visit mother's grave, the grave at the hazel tree, and tell her I just want to go to the king's festival. The baker's still going, the cow, the cape, the slipper is pure as gold. And the wife like, the hair. They all come together, into the woods, it's time to go, It may be all in vain, I know, into the woods, but even so, I have to take the journey. Into the woods, the path is straight, you know it well, but who can tell? Into the woods to lift the spell, into the woods to visit mother, into the woods to fetch the things, to make the potion to go to the festival. And now we're getting like Jack and Jack's mother and a bunch of the rest of the company. Into the woods without regret, the choice is made, the task is set. Into the woods, but not forgetting why I'm on the journey. Into the woods to get our wish, I don't care how, the time is now. Into the woods to sell the cow, into the woods to get the money, into the woods to lift the spell, to make the potion to go to the festival. And Little Red Riding Hood comes skipping out, into the woods to grandmother's house, into the woods to grandmother's house.
I still wish to go to the festival.
The cow is white as milk,
but how am I ever to get to the festival? I know, I'll visit mother's grave, the grave at the willow tree, and tell her I just want to go to the king's festival.
Into the woods, it's time to go, it may be all in vain, I know. Into the woods, but even so, I have to take the journey.
Into the woods, the path is straight, you know it well,
but who can tell?
Into the woods to lift the spell,
into the woods to visit mother,
into the woods to sell the cow, to get the money,
to go to the festival,
into the woods to grandmother's house, into the woods to grandmother's house.
The way is clear.
Well, this again is such a very smart turning on its head on the notion, you know, has been said so much. And I, you know, a huge Howard Ashman fan. I love Howard Ashman. And he has popularized so much the idea of the want song and like talking about, you know, how you know, part of your world is based on the whole tradition of the character I want song. And, you know, sure. What character saying what they want and what they need, and the audience knows. And for here, though, now that we are seeing, though, this is not going to be a show about a single character's want or wish. This right. is going to be about all of these, and but in order to do that, by laying it out clearly and repeatedly, you know, even though you're dealing with, you know, a half dozen or so characters already, and we're about to get more and more of their wants and wishes, by already underlying the fact that we're going to keep repeating this, so in a way that you will understand, and it is, you know, still ostensibly a show, you know, for children, quote unquote, and imparting lessons, that the repetition of that, now you're going out of this, you know, 10, 15 minute long number. Now you're understanding, yeah. Though, you see when you see each of them later on, you know what Jack's looking for, what she's looking for, what he's looking for, what they're looking for, you know, all of that sort of stuff is really laid out pretty cleanly.
Yeah, everyone is stating what they want. Because they're singing over top of each other in a lot of these parts, I think sometimes it's could be difficult to know exactly what each person is saying.
Yes.
I will say, like, Cinderella says, oh, I'm going to go to Mother's grave at the Hazel Tree. For whatever reason, the movie changes that to Willow Tree. I don't know why, but they've changed it to Willow Tree. That's not a big deal. The big thing I just wanted to point out is that they're talking over top of each other, but they make very clear, like, the baker's wife says, the hair. Like, that is very clear and plainly heard. And I do think it's important, like, of all the list of ingredients, why the hair is super important. One, because we know that it's going to be Rapunzel's hair she goes after, which is ultimately what they do. But we also find out that it can't be something that the witch touched. So it actually becomes one of the more important plot points. But also later on, when the witch cuts Rapunzel's hair, like, that is a huge moment of, like, that relationship, like, fracturing completely sort of thing. So I think there is a big important reason why the hair is so much highlighted as an ingredient that is sung through and not over top of something else.
Yeah. And you know, and furthermore, too, it also... from a just kind of technical standpoint, it gives the wife something to sing so that Baker and Cinderella can take a breath before they both start singing together Into the Woods, right. It's Time to Go. But, you know, furthermore, laying the seeds for, well, this is going to be quote unquote mother and father at the end of the show. Baker and Cinderella are the two stand-ins
by
the end. And, you know, and the wife, you know, the wife is now set on her own. The wife is off on her own here. And the two of them kind of take on the lead sort of roles here, which they're going to have to assume whether they like it or not by the end of the show, which is, again, I was looking to see if it was even more clever and if we had, but there's not, you know, Jack's mother and wife and people are kind of weaved in. So there's not really a moment where you really see here Jack read, you know, Baker and, you know, Cinderella sing by themselves. Further clarify that. But still, you definitely, by having the two of them lead that off, you definitely see that, like, it's, again, always a question with this show of who is the lead? What is the quote-unquote lead of the show?
Yes.
And it's kind of all of them and none of them all at once. But here you see that Baker and Cinderella are going to be somewhat equally. We know that Baker and his wife have been featured very prominently, and they have the main story we're seeing now. But you're also setting up that Cinderella is going to be about as equally important as him as well going into this.
Yeah, I think that's a really great call out, because something that I want to try and point out throughout the rest of this season is, yeah, there's occasions where the Baker and Cinderella are harmonizing with one another before they ever become like a couple, quote unquote. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This is how the number ends, which is they all come together saying, the way is clear, the light is good, I have no fear, nor no one should. The woods are just trees, the trees are just wood, no need to be afraid there. There's something in the glade there. There's a little bit of a orchestration piece. Into the woods without delay, but careful not to lose the way. Into the woods, who knows what may be lurking on the journey. Into the woods to get the thing that makes it worth the journeying. Into the woods to see the king, to sell the cow, to make the potion. To see, to sell, to get, to bring, to make, to lift, to go to the festival. Into the woods, into the woods, into the woods, and out of the woods, and home before dark.
Something in the glade there. Into the woods without delay, but careful not to lose the way. Into the woods, who knows what may be lurking on the journey. Into the woods to get the thing that makes it worth the journeying. Into the woods to see the king, to sell the cow,
to make the potion,
to see, to sell, to get, to bring, to make, to lift, to go to the festival. Into the woods. Into the woods.
But they don't get home before dark.
No.
Lightning flash. Okay. So what do we want to mention here as this thing wraps up?
For me, one thing that always really stands out, because, you know, it's always that hard question of, like, what's your favorite Sondheim show and all that. And I got to throw, I really love Assassins to a set. Like, I love this show.
You're right.
I love it. Like, kind of my finding out about Sondheim was Into the Woods, Then when I went to college, someone sang a song from Assassins, and I just, Unworthy of Your Love, and I did the whole darkness of that, like everything, like, oh, crazy. I love it. And then going back to Merrily. So it's kind of like that moment from like Merrily on for me is really my Merrily through like Assassins or like my four shows of Sondheim that I'm just like, can't get enough of. And coming from Merrily, you know, you see so much of like Sondheim's style as it's evolving. And he does a lot of these things of like the bump, bump, ba-dum, ba-bum. A character comes out, says something. Another character comes, say something, you know? And he does that a lot in Assassins. He does that a lot in Merrily, more through the chorus coming out and Merrily, we roll it, all that stuff. But I love that sort of, you know, not as much as in Sunday, but you see so much of like, even starting with Sweeney Todd, where he does that, take a repetition of a theme, using it for segues, but also it's not just transition music. It's also imparting important ideas of the show, whether it's the time changes in Merrily, whether it's what these characters want in Into the Woods, whether it's what the assassins want in Assassins. And I just always, every time I hear this, this especially Assassins, makes me think this and the second Midnights and the first Midnights. And like when he gets that little glump, 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 glump thing going that he gets a lot in his later on career. I don't know. It always just like warms me up. I love it. I love hearing that.
Yeah, I just like, I love how this ends, right? Just like to see, to sell, to get, to bring, to make, to lift. Like where it's like, oh yeah, okay, we're all on this journey. They are literally like entering into the woods. The woods is a metaphor for life or for hardships or however you want to actually read that metaphor that's going on. I will say like, because they're all singing the same thing, I Have No Fear Nor No One Should, the basic reprise of what Little Red said earlier on in the song. This does come across as like a bit of false bravado, right? It's like everyone's going off to do their own thing. As an audience member, we must be kind of in the back of our minds like, well, this isn't going to be a show that they're just going to go and get their thing easily either. So this does come off across more as like, you think it's going to go easy, but there has to be some hardships along the way. We haven't seen. Oh, yeah. I was going to say too, because right after that, when they say there's something in the glade there, I believe in that PBS version, that's, you see like the stepsisters and everyone in the carriage go across.
Yes,
stage.
That's the carriage coming. Yeah.
This could be absolutely a false memory on my part. But to my memory, when I saw Into the Woods, the one production I saw, it absolutely was the carriage. You saw the carriage go across, but the wolf also came across the stage at the same time. I don't know if that was just like that's a thing or whatever happens, but I like that.
Here's what I think that is, because I was watching that this morning. It is the Tony performance from 1988, from the original Tonys. Okay. Watch it. It's weird. It's weird the way they do it, because they start with, and they have Angela Lansbury introduces it,
as
and she does narration. She does, and she's like, once in a kingdom there was a boy. They do a quick, like, you know, or they do like quick Cinderella, I wish, and a boy, Jack, I wish, Little Red, I wish, you know, and they do them in front. Clearly, it was recorded ahead of time. It was pre-recorded. They jump to the witch's rap where Felicia Rashad, who was doing the role at the time, is doing the witch. They jump to that. Then they jump. They do like a smash cut to this, like Into the Woods. And they do a crazy like 30-second montage where it's like they throw in every little gag from the show. So it's not really the exact show. And it's clearly they did it on their stage, on the Martin Beck stage. And you see like within, while they're doing Into the Woods, It's Time to Go, you see them coming across Little Red, or Cinderella runs out. They drop the dress on her. She grabs it and runs. The wolf comes out, does a bit, runs off. The carriage comes across. Cinderella's prince comes out. They do all of this like madcap stuff. And then they do a smash cut to them singing Children Will Listen, which then you can tell that part was clearly done in the live on the Tony Awards performance.
Right,
and then the
right.
cast comes out, because you don't see, they don't have the risers anymore and they don't have the full stage set anymore, but all the actors come out in costume. So that may be what you're thinking of. That may
maybe
be
that's
like,
what it was.
Yeah, because it's a weird, it's almost like a weird commercial. It's like a weird montage. Yeah. That they do that you don't see often at the Tonys, and it feels like one of those like early 80s commercials.
I've always said too, like there are some exceptions. I mean, the bonus episode I did about the Wild Party is like the exception. I usually don't like the montage numbers that they do at the Tony Awards. I always think it comes off awkward. I do think that Into the Woods one is very awkward and doesn't sell the show, don't think, very well personally. But anyways, if I was a director and if I was allowed to do it, I would also have the wolf show up in that little, like, there's something in the glade there, just to, like, underscore, like, there's danger about to happen as well.
Yeah, which I basically would stage it like that, because, again, I'm always mindful of making it worth all the cast members' times and the kids' times, and the parents want to see them. And since I did do things like I didn't have the prince and the wolf played by the same actor, split up roles. So to give the wolf a little more, I did, this was like a montage where all of a sudden we saw the princes and we saw everyone kind of walking through the woods and all that, which is kind of cool too, which does help.
So I guess any last thoughts or feelings about this prologue?
I kind of feel the same way going through this now, much as I did after, you know, you finish blocking it and you just go, whoa, that's a lot, you know, but the thing that sucks when blocking it, because, you know, generally, you know, started from the beginning with it. It's a lot to do all of this and learning that song and getting it. Sure. And you get done and you're like, yay, we're done. Oh, now we have like an hour and 45 left to block. Okay.
I saw this video showed up on my TikTok algorithm. But the joke was, is like coming in on your first day of rehearsal of Into the Woods, thinking this is going to be so easy, and then being totally shattered by the opening song.
Yeah.
It's really hard to get the timing right. It's like, I wish, but like you have to, like, there's five people have to come in exactly the right beat, and if the piano goes off, then it's like, okay, we're lost. I don't know where I'm at anymore.
Yeah, and I mean, again, going to the junior version where you're singing to the pre-recorded tracks, it can be tough, especially sometimes they're good about giving you little like dings and little things to help you get into it if you're not gonna have a live conductor in front of you, but other times they don't, and if you get lost, your underscoring is just bum bum ba da dum bum. But for like ever and ever and ever and ever. So like, you know, God help you if you get off. And yeah, it's a lot, but it's definitely one of those like, God, it's so well put together. Like just as a piece in of itself. Once you get to the end of it, you almost feel like you've accomplished something, even though it's literally just beginning.
I know. So you just want to like stand up and applaud basically at that point. I mean, I would imagine as a performer, just being able to get this done each night is just like, oh God, okay, we did it. We were able to do it. It's easy sailing from here on out.
Yes. Yeah, and probably that original cast doing this, and then when they still had Second Midnight coming up, they were like, oh, crap. we essentially have to do it again later on.
That does bring us to this idea, though, is like if you were to rate this song or rank this song in the entire score of Into the Woods, where would this place? Would this be like in your, you know, top five, middle five, bottom five? Like where would it show up in your rankings?
It would have to be in my top five. You got like just everything is here. I don't know if it'd be my very top. And that's a tough question. I'm not even sure what, you know, probably a No One Is Alone. Like it's hard to beat that song.
Right.
You know, and some of the, you know, Your Fault, Last Midnight, all that is all up there. But for me, this has got to be in the top five.
Yeah. I was trying to think about this. I think where it would fall is probably like the top of the middle, if not the the bottom of the top. Like I don't know exactly. It's very strong. It's a very, very strong song. I love listening to this. Oftentimes if I just throw my music on shuffle, I go into like my musical section that I've made and curated for myself. I'll just throw it on shuffle. I'm like, this comes on, I'm like, well, this is 14 minutes. I get to just sit back and relax and have a good old time. This is the first time I'm gonna do this. I should have been doing this like from the very beginning of the show. I'm gonna keep my rankings as we go through this. So I mean it's in the number one spot now, but it's gonna see. As we get more songs placed into this list. But yeah, I feel like it's going to be top of the middle or bottom of the top, somewhere in that section for me.
Yeah, I mean, it feels almost like a little bit of a cheat to say, like, especially if you're going to say, oh, it's my favorite song, because it's like, well, it's about like 20 songs in one, so it's a little
that
bit
is
of a
true.
Cheat. but it's definitely, you know, not a favorite in terms of I'm just belting in my car or something like this. Right. Like, it's fun in some ways because you get to play all the different characters, but like, if I just want like a heartrending song or something like that, of course you want to, you know, get to one of the solos, but...
I'm honestly constantly doing the Witcher's rap as I walk down the street and people cross over to the other side. They do not want to be beside me.
It's a good way to clear it.
As a final question this season, this is the question I have decided to wrap up every conversation with. Kevin, do you have a favorite fairy tale?
I haven't been able to cheat since I'm the first episode. I haven't been able to listen to what your question's going to be this time around. I'm so stumped on this one. Well, the ones from this show, well, like I said, like the baker and his wife story definitely like is the one that resonates with me, but again, sure, that's a cheat because that's not like a real quote-unquote, you know, fairy tale. You know, the Cinderella story is hard not to get behind because everybody feels like the outsider, you know, no matter who you are, even like whoever might be, you know, the most quote-unquote important or popular person in the world feels like an outsider, feels like a loser. I mean, maybe not Tom Cruise. I don't know. That guy's got a lot of bravado. But like, apart from him.
I do want to see his Cinderella, though, at some point.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, everybody has their moments of feeling like the uncool one. So, I mean, it's hard not to have that. And then to have the whole, you get the whole realization of like, ooh, what is it like to feel the popular one and all that? I mean, I guess from fairy tales that are not in this show, I always like the weird ones. Like Rumpelstiltskin is like the weirdest story. Like none of it really makes sense. Yeah. But like, I like the weirder, like, you know, Grimm Brothers type of stories and like the stuff that just really makes no, you know, clear sense. But yeah, no, that's a good question.
It's a really dark one. Like you can get some really like not popular ones if you dig into like the Grimm's fairy tale collection. Once again, I will reveal my answer at the very end of this season. But it's going to be fun to see what other people's favorite fairy tales are. Kevin, thank you so much for joining me in this like behemoth of a song that we were able to accomplish. If people wanted to follow you, see what you're up to, what's the easiest way to do so online?
I mean, I'm on Instagram, just my full name, Kevin Quillinan. You can see the spelling and you know the title on Instagram. You can look me up. I don't post a ton of stuff there, but you can also just follow what we do at riversidetheater.com, and because we do a lot of cool stuff. We've been really ramping up our education program this year, and you know, getting back in the swing of things.
Anything coming up in October, November, that time period?
October, November. Yes, we are gearing up towards our festival. We're rebranding it as the Winterfest this time around. We have not done our Festival of Trees in the last 3 years for obvious reasons, and getting back into swing of things. And this really supports, it's called Winterfest. It supports everything that we do educationally at the theater. We're going to be showing all of these community engagement groups that we've been enlisting this year and working with Boys and Girls Club and all these local groups. And we, as a centerpiece of all of it, we're doing Finding Nemo Jr., which is nice. Kind of the area premiere of that show with our students. And so, yeah, you can find, that's the first weekend of December. So you can find out all the information if you're local or if you're going to be in the area. Come on, check out Riverside Theater. We do a lot of really cool stuff that we're all very proud of.
Cool. Well, thank you again for being a guest here this week.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for trusting me with this huge song. I hope we did okay.
We did great. Thank you so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. This is an independent production, so you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Putting Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we're going to be talking about Cinderella at the Grave. I also like to talk to birds. As always, a big thank you to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.